Good morning and welcome to the 15th meeting in 2023 of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. Apologies have been received from the committee's new member, Keith Brown, who attended our last couple of meetings as substitute. On behalf of the committee, I would like to put on record our thanks to Kenneth Gibson for his hard work and support given to the committee in his role as convener over the last 2 years. So the first item on our agenda is to choose a new convener. The Parliament has agreed that only members of the Scottish National Party are eligible for nomination as convener of this committee. I ask any member to make a nomination.
I nominate John Mason.
Thank you, Michelle Thompson. And do members agree to choose John as our convener? That's agreed. So we'll do a little bit of shuffling if John wants to take the chair.
Right, I think that's us in place now. Well, I thank the committee for my appointment and I look forward to continuing to work with you all. Can I also thank Michael Mara for stepping in to convene over the last few weeks as deputy convener. And can I say that I do hope Kenneth Gibson will be able to rejoin us before too long. We will today start taking oral evidence in our inquiry into the Scottish Government's Public Service Reform Programme. And we'll be hearing from Anthony Clark, Executive Director at Audit Scotland, Professor John Connolly, Head of Department of Social Sciences at Glasgow Caledonian University, and Alison Payne, Research Director at Reform Scotland. We had also hoped to have Dave Moxon from the STUC, but he is unable to be with us today, and we may be able to get him at a future occasion, but he did submit evidence, and we might refer to that. So I welcome you all to the meeting. We intend to allow about 90 minutes for this session, and if witnesses would like to be brought into the discussion at any point, please indicate to the clerks or myself, and we can then call you in. And we have written submissions, I think, from you all, so we will just move straight to questions. So if I can start by asking one or two questions myself, and the first one was something based on something that the Deputy First Minister, the previous Deputy First Minister, I think, John Swinney, had said, which was he was very much leaving the idea of reform up to individual public bodies rather than trying to drive it from the centre. And I just wonder what your thoughts are on whether we can do that, we should do that, or whether there needs to be at least some driving from the centre. Mr. Clark, will I start with you on that one?
I think it's very understandable that one would want to engage with public bodies to understand how reform can be implemented at local level, because reform needs to reflect local circumstances, the needs of communities, the different nature and configuration of public bodies. So I think there's merit in having that local focus. But equally, I think it's very important that there's a sense of purpose and clarity in terms of what the Scottish Government is trying to achieve from its reform agenda. And I think you'll see from our submission that we've highlighted in previous audit reports that quite often it's been quite difficult to assess the success or otherwise of reform because there's been insufficient clarity in terms of what the intended outcomes were. So I think there is a need to strike a balance between local discretion and autonomy, but national leadership. And it does seem at the moment there's more to do to be clear about what the actual intended outcomes of the reform agenda is above and beyond the five key themes and the principles that are underpinning the reform agenda at the moment. So I think there is a question there around clarity of outcomes and that does require further work by the Scottish Government.
So do you think the government needs to state outcomes and if so, what should these be? I mean, it was suggested before that there would be certain numbers of staff, for example, returning to pre-COVID levels.
Yes, I wasn't suggesting that there should be specific targets necessarily, if that's what you thought I was implying. I think one of the questions you highlighted in the inquiry was what should underpin the government's reform agenda? And so I guess my starting point for that would be going back in many ways to the Christie principles in terms of high quality public services, that support prevention, improve outcomes, and put citizens and service users at the heart of the reform agenda. And I think what needs to flow from that is clarity about what that means in terms of structures, what that means in terms of resource allocation and what that means in terms of the future shape of public services. It seems to me that it's quite clear that the way public services are currently configured, delivered and resourced probably isn't sustainable in the medium to long term. I think that's widely accepted. What seems to flow from that is change is needed. My point, I think, is that there's greater clarity is needed about what that change will look like.
OK, thank you. Professor Connolly, more central direction, more local autonomy?
Yeah, my view would be that I think there needs to be a new philosophy of how we look at public services and public service reform in Scotland. I think the idea of localism is very important and I'd very much support localism. But I think there has to be some supported localism as well. So a central level direction and capacity within the system remains important. If we look at some of the issues or the developments we've seen within the public sector in Scotland over the past decade, if you look at initiatives like the Community Empowerment Agenda, very much a heavy localism-based initiative. But I think the evidence is suggesting that community organisations, local government, CPPs, require national level support when it comes to evaluating their contribution towards outcomes that are often set nationally but required to be delivered locally. So I don't think an overly localist empowerment based model is particularly desirable, although it is important to have localism. It's important that local stakeholders are able to understand their position within the wider public sector, and actually that there is capacity at that partnership level within the system. Because, you know, if you think about the public sector in Scotland as a multi-level polity, you know, you've got the central government, you've also got a partnership national level, but also you've got local level as well. I would be worried about there being a vacuum in the middle, so to speak, because I think localism does have to be supported.
OK, well, we might come back to that and explore it a bit more. But Ms Payne, Reform Scotland, your evidence, you're quite strong, I think, on pushing that it should be local levels making decisions. So maybe you could comment on some of this.
Definitely. I think localism is a really important thing, and it's important that local circumstances and needs are taken into account, and that local authorities and different communities have the ability to react to their differing needs. I do think, though, it comes back to what do you mean by reform? Looking through the sort of the previous evidence, there was a sort of feeling that reform was basically trying to ensure our public services could live within their means. It was trying to react to declining budgets. That's what we would argue is that's not real reform. We need public service reform, and we need partnership in terms of working between the local authorities, local bodies and central government in terms of how do we radically change public service delivery. How do we meet the challenges of our changing demographics, our issues around the amount of revenue that we're raising? And I think that needs a collaborative approach so that we can have centrally set objectives and outcomes in terms of what we're looking at wanting to deliver, but then there should be local discretion in terms of delivery and how those are met. I think if you're looking at something, say, like the National Care Service, that's very much taking away from local authorities. There needs to be more of a, what are we trying to achieve? What is it going to do? It's not just about cutting budgets, cutting costs, but actually improving delivery, improving efficiency, ensuring better outcomes for all. And I think that needs to be more of a collaborative discussion at the start, and sort of saying, looking at the longer term, what do we want to achieve? What are the goals that we want to achieve? How do we want to reorganise our services? And then look at how those can be delivered in the different areas across Scotland.
Yeah, I mean, improving efficiency, in one sense, if the budget is limited and councils and health boards and all the rest have to work within a restricted budget, in a sense, does that not force efficiency?
Yes, but efficiencies aren't necessarily reform. And I think if you're just trying to cut your cloth accordingly, that's not necessarily going to give you the reform that you require. I think, going back to Christy, the importance of early intervention was really highlighted. And I'm not sure that we've actually taken that on, that we've looked at in areas such as the NHS. Where are the early intervention programmes? That, yes, we have to deal with the firefighting and the costs pre-COVID and post-COVID, the increasing waiting lists and problems there. But those will only get worse unless we start looking at early intervention programmes. How can we look at services so that we can actually start delivering preventative programmes and how we can work with others so that we can change how things operate. We have changing demographics. We've got, in terms of the revenue, we're going to have challenges with a shrinking working age population. So we can't even just fiddle around with our income tax levels. There are challenges in the future. And I think from looking through the sort of previous discussions that the committee have had, we really need to look at the longer term. Have that discussion about longer-term reform and what we can do now, as well as the sort of dealing with the immediately revenue challenges, but actually look into the longer term, so how we can fix things now so that we're not still having this conversation in another 12 years and saying how we really need to do Christie.
Okay, there's quite... okay, Mr Clark, you come back in. Yeah.
I just wanted to build on some of the points that Ms Payne has made, really. It seems to me that some of the big challenges facing Scotland at the moment, such as child poverty, climate change, addressing inequalities, are not things that can be dealt with by individual public bodies. And one of the dangers of asking public bodies to focus on their own budgets is it might force people to just look at things that will work for them, but actually won't address those complex, cross-cutting issues that are the real long-term challenges facing Scotland at the moment. So therefore, I think that does force you to think about how do you get reform as a cross-public sector agenda, rather than just something that's focused on by a council, a health board, or a fire and rescue service. And the number of things flow from that, I think, which you've heard from previous witnesses in other evidence sessions, which are questions about how the accountability arrangements work. So what are people rewarded for doing? How are they incentivised to make change and reform? That's not just about reducing budgets, it's about improving public services. We've heard people talk in the past about disobeying boundaries, and that being a key kind of driver for delivering Christie. Well, disobeying boundaries means looking beyond your own individual organisation, and yet at the moment one of the drivers of the current stated reform agenda is about individual public bodies doing what's right for them. Now, I'm not saying that it's entirely wrong to ask public bodies to balance their books. I'm an auditor. I want public bodies to balance their books. I want money to be spent properly. My point, I think, is that there's a broader cross-cutting issue here that does require thought as part of the reform agenda.
OK, so I was coming to you next, Professor Connolly, anyway, because Mr Clark's kind of led me into where I was going anyway, because I'd been reading your paper on the co-production of health and social care services, which was interesting. And I think my question, I mean, there's a whole lot that's already been mentioned, but we'll explore that later as we go along. We're kind of scene-setting today. But on the specific issue, I mean, yes, individual organisations will be quite efficient maybe if we press their budget, but would they work together with other organisations? And I mean, the health and social care is an example. But do you think without central pressure, organisations would look at joint working and co-production and more of that?
I mean, the health and social care partnerships I've worked with and researched indicate to me that they're very happy to collaborate across boundaries. It's having the opportunities to do so. Individuals within the workforce within health and social care are often really constrained in terms of their capacity, and that gives more reason in many ways to have some kind of overseeing leadership to allow for collaboration across boundaries.
When you say opportunities for collaboration or whatever, are you meaning time or being allowed to do it? Or
time, space, the infrastructure,
right,
and having the leadership in place to allow for that. I mean, if we think about the nature of the modern public sector now, there is more of a requirement now than ever before to work together, because social problems have so many dimensions to them that require joined up, you know, approaches to governance. And I think the history of public administration scholarship indicates that it's actually quite difficult to get joined up services right. But it does require interdisciplinarity, working across professional boundaries, but it does require leadership in that space. So when you spoke earlier about what John Swinney was saying, I guess that raised some alarm bells in my mind about what would that mean then for collaboration across boundaries, because I think that's becoming increasingly important in the modern world that we exist within. So I do believe that structures are important, localism is important, but two things can be true at the same time, and I think it's important to get that balance, making sure that there's networks within the system and people skilled within the public sector to do collaboration. That's the other thing. I mean, we often assume that there's just those skill sets there and leadership within the public sector to allow for that. And it might be the case, but when have we ever done a skills audit? When have we actually looked to the workforce and said, well, to what extent is there opportunities to develop public service leaders in that way? So I do think, thinking about the long term, that's something that we might want to think about, is, you know, building capacity within the system in terms of the individual professions to allow for leadership across boundaries. That's become ever more important.
OK, I think we're getting more questions than answers here, actually. Ms Payne, do you want to come in on this collaboration kind of idea?
Thank you. Yeah, I think it's important that collaboration is from the bottom up. I think there have been examples of where, you know, we have local authorities that work together, but it has to be that they are coming together rather than forced collaboration. I also think that there is a danger about collaboration and integration just being a kind of golden bullet, almost, because, I mean, we're on to our fourth attempt at integrating social care, health and social care. There has to be, you know, it's simply saying, well, push things together. We have proven through health and social care it doesn't always work. I think bottom-up, enabling people, as has been said, sort of bringing that collaborative approach from the bottom, where you have shared circumstances and shared needs that can be worked together. But I think being forced down, a top-down approach, isn't the way to go.
OK, well, thank you. That's all the questions for me just now. Can I just say, too, I should have said at the beginning, you don't need to touch your microphones or buttons or any of these things. That'll all be done for you. So now I'm going to hand over to Ross Greer.
Thanks. Convener, just to start off with, interested in some of the comments that were in the Audit Scotland paper, Anthony, and one particular line in it that said that given the trajectory our public finances are going to be on over the next couple of years, small savings won't be enough. If I could reword that slightly, is it Audit Scotland's position that at present the Scottish Government is overcommitted, that there are entire areas of service provision that we are going to have to cut back on to cease? We can't just trim each service and reform each service to be more efficient. More drastic decisions than that will be required.
I wouldn't use the words you've used, Mr. Greer, but I think it seems clear to us that some fundamental questions need to be asked about the nature of the offer and what public services can deliver in the current context of increasing demand, you know, the fiscal pressures, the kind of demographics and the challenges that Scotland's faced pre-pandemic around child poverty deprivation and creating a sustainable economic base for Scotland as well. To try and answer your question, it feels to us as though we need to think very hard about what the nature of public services are in that context. And it seems to flow from that the current models certainly need questioning. You know, the way in which we currently provide the health services reflects the post-Second World War settlement. The nature of disease is changing. The challenges around child poverty are much greater now than perhaps they have been for many, many years, although we're seeing progress in Scotland. So we do think there's a need to have a very first principled conversation about what are public services here to do, what should they look like, who should provide them, and importantly, what role do communities play in that as well? I think that's a message you heard from Professor Mitchell when he came to speak to you. The ambitions of Christie, the ambitions of the Community Empowerment Act around bringing community capacity to play around public services and improving outcomes for communities feels like it's underdeveloped and not delivering the ambitions that we'd hoped when the legislation was passed. So yes, I think we do think there's a big question to ask about what we can deliver in the current financial context, if that answers your question, Mr. Greer.
It does, yeah. Thanks. If I could ask the other panel essentially the same question. Is the Scottish Government overcommitted relative to the financial resources that are realistically going to be available for the next couple of years? Alison, if you'd like
sure,
to start.
Sure. I think the demographic challenges on the longer term, yes. We are going to have a shrinking working age population. So unless we do look at how we properly reform public services, how we manage what look at our revenue, then yes, we're going to have an older population. And in many ways, you can see that the NHS is a victim of its own success. We're living longer, but as we live longer, there are more demands. We need to talk about how we meet those demands. So I think it's looking into the longer term, and I think it's important to start now having these conversations so that we can talk about, well, how do we pay for social care? How do we pay for... how do we pool our resources and pay for these things that we're going to have increasing demands on?
The Reform Scotland paper is quite interesting in that it brings up a lot of points that this committee and others will be familiar with, particularly in relation to the NHS or in the need to move away from treating illness towards prevention. Mm-hmm. But given particularly the financial powers currently available to the Scottish Government, limitations on borrowing powers. If we are to allocate new resources for prevention, they need to come from somewhere else at the moment. There's not an additional sum of money. We can't take out a loan and do that. Does Reform Scotland have areas that you would propose cutting from? Because not to put you on the spot, but everybody comes to Parliament saying we need to spend more money on X, including prevention, which makes complete sense. It's much harder to get folk to propose where the money would come from.
I think there's a bit of different... There's some different options. So one example, for example, is that we have talked about care, looking at the ongoing care costs. And we have said that if we were to put in a temporary increase in income tax so that we could start reforming social care now, that we could actually look at developing the sort of the proper care needs that were identified in Feely, and that we've got a proper social care system for the elderly. But at the same time as doing that, we set up a cross-party commission that brings in and that collaborative approach that others have spoken about across parties to look at, well, actually, how do we, with the demographic challenges that we're facing and all the other challenges, actually ensure that we've got a proper care system that can look after people when they're older. And so I think it's about, yes, you're right. You know, if we want to deal with the firefighting that we've got to deal with and start introducing reform and early intervention, it costs money. And proper reform, I've done, looking into early intervention can save money in the longer term, but there will be upfront costs. And I think it's about being honest to that. So that's one way where we said we would increase revenue in a short term. Another one where I think there's ways and means that we can look at is, we mentioned in the paper, is around about tuition fees. And there have clearly been cuts to the college and further education budgets. So one way we've said is we would like to look at how tuition fees are managed. Is there a way of introducing a graduate cap? Could we use then develop systems that we could still offer free tuition if people stayed and worked in Scotland with certain skills for a certain period of time, and develop different ideas? But I think if we're being honest, and instead of that kind of trying to score points with everybody, but looking across the piece, we can't just fiddle around with income tax and sort of say, right, we can put up a whole load of new taxes on income and we'll suddenly be able to pay for everything. We can't. So there's that honesty with the public and saying, look, these are the challenges. Do you want an NHS that's going to meet its centenary? Do you want to still have all these services? If so, how are we going to pay for them? I think there would be a mixture of short and longer term decisions as to how we do that.
You're absolutely right that there's a limitation on how much we can realistically raise from income tax. I don't think we're there yet, but we're pretty close. There's not much more that can be raised from that. The SDUC, in their paper, though, they published a separate tax paper last December, I believe, that, yes, had income tax proposals in it, but it also had proposals for new, particularly local taxes, as well as reforms to non-domestic rates. Your paper for this session is somewhat more sceptical about solving this problem through simply raising more revenue. So I'd be interested in your thoughts on the SDUC's proposal, which is essentially we don't need to cut services. We have revenue-raising options that we've not explored yet.
Well, we've also, not in the submission of this paper, but we've published a report, Tax and Times, which talked about similar points about that we have other tax-raising powers that we've not used. There are tax-raising powers around wealth taxes, and particularly around mobile wealth taxes, that we could look at. There are certainly other things that we could do, but there are no golden bullets. I think that's the sort of thing is why you're raising the money, and it's to raise, if you're wanting to raise the money so you can actually implement proper reform, not just carrying on. And I think that we have to be honest and say, look, more money isn't the solution to the problems facing our public services. More money to enable reform, proper reform, is different. And I think that's something that we would agree with, that you could look at, well, how do we raise revenue so we can enable that proper, effective reform that looks at early intervention, that looks at the sort of the radical issues that Christy wanted to deal with, then yes, those are perfectly, we would agree with a lot of that. I think simply raising money to try and maintain and keep our head in the sand, we wouldn't agree with that sort of approach.
Thank you, John. Feel free to comment on anything that I've just asked. If I could also ask you, because I'm conscious of time, I'd be interested in your thoughts on the balance between quality, consultation, co-design in a reform process and how swift we're able to deliver it, because we are simultaneously met with complaints often that there has not been enough consultation, co-design, etc., but also that the speed of reform in Scotland is glacial. In fact, I think glacial is the word used in the Reform Scotland paper. There's clearly a tension between those two things. If we want that quality consultation, co-design, it takes longer, particularly in relation to the sustainability of our public finances. We don't have as long as we might want here. How would you suggest we balance those competing demands?
I think that's a fair point. I think they are competing demands, but I think that there's been perhaps some missed opportunities to get this right. And I think that sometimes you do have to put up with a little bit of delay in order to actually have that vision and the systems that fall in place behind that. So I think it's worth taking the time to get it right, rather than perhaps doing things on a more reactionary, ad hoc basis. So there are tensions, and I do recognise that. But I think the benefits outweigh the costs in actually doing it properly. And I think, just to go back to your other point about efficiencies, the way I look at public sector reform and governance issues is around the ideas around public value. So how do we know what's working and working well? Can we embed social return on investment methodologies into how we set up our programmes and services? Is it possible to actually think about how we evaluate what we do better? In the early years of the SNP administration, there was a focus on evaluation far more. And I think that's kind of petered away for whatever reason. And I do feel that there's now an opportunity to think carefully about how we equip public servants and those that they work with within wider civil society to evaluate better, to evaluate what works. You know, we've probably all heard this, you know, idea of the, you know, what work centres and the different ways in which research tries to get into policy. But I do think there could be more attention given to that. So efficiency is important, but you have to understand what it is we have to be efficient about and how to go about that. So I think, to me, that's a call for better evaluation.
Thanks, Roch. Conscious of time, convener? I'm OK, grand. So on that point of better evaluation, whose role do you think that should be, going back to the convener's original line of question around should reform take place within each individual public body, should it be led from the centre, with some elements of evaluation, is it more appropriate that takes place externally through independent review? If we're trying to coalesce and have a consistent strategic direction when it comes to evaluation, collection of quality data, etc., who should be leading on that? Should we leave it up to each body? Should we leave it up to each local authority when it's their service provision? Or is this something that needs centralised and delivered in a consistent manner?
I think there has to be evaluation built into national agencies whereby there can be the capacity there to go and develop and train those in local areas to do these things better. I think there's lots of assumptions that are made that public servants who work locally have the skills and capacities to actually evaluate effectively. So I do think it does require some national training. You know, in the past, at the UK level, they used to have the National School of Government. Could it be the case that we have a similar thing in Scotland, whereby we have an academy for public servants to equip them better, to evaluate what they do and the services that they provide in a collaborative way? So I believe that evaluation actually isn't the responsibility of one part of the system. I do think it does need some overseeing, but I do believe that if you're running a programme at local government level or within an NHS board, you should be able to have the skills to evaluate the performance of what you're doing. And it is a bit different from performance management, you know, and performance measurement. It's actually about thinking about the outcomes of what you're trying to achieve. And I think, to be fair, you know, the government has, over the years, talked about outcomes at a broader level through the National Performance Framework and so on. But the thing that's been missing is that capacity to be able to evaluate against those outcomes. So hopefully that helps to answer some of that.
Thanks very much. Anthony?
As Professor Connolly says, it clearly has to operate at both national, regional and local level in terms of the evaluation. And one needs to be clear what one's trying to achieve at national level. But success at national level may look quite different to success at local level. And I think one of the challenges around the reform agenda and public service performance more generally is trying to make those links between what's happening at a local level to its performance at a regional and national level. So the contribution effect is often quite difficult. And I've got a great deal of sympathy for the Scottish Government in terms of the challenges they face in understanding how well reform is operating at those various tiers of governance. It's a really important issue to get right, though, and it seems to me it's more important now than ever before, given the pressure on the public purse. We have been critical, as you know, around aspects of government reform where it hasn't been clear what the intended outcome was, and our recent NHS overview report highlighted the need for greater clarity around what success looks like in terms of getting the NHS back on track post-COVID. The issue in the NHS is replicated in other bits of government as well, so this is an area where further progress is needed.
Thanks, Arch. That's all from me, Convener.
Okay, thanks very much for that. If we get time at the end, we'll give people a chance to come back in. Douglas Lumsden next.
Thanks, Convener. Just from reading the submissions and what I've heard today, some things I've picked up. No clarity, pace needs to increase, no targets, no evaluation, no real focus on prevention and intervention, and an implementation gap between policy and delivering. How does the Scottish Government get this reform agenda back on track? Because it seems quite damning so far. Professor Connolly, do you want to go first?
Thank you. I think it's fair to say there are some systemic issues, and you've summarised those really well. I do believe that now's an opportunity, and this is actually a really good example of collaboration here today, to hear the voices of different civil society organisations who have got something to say about this agenda. I do think there could be a better interface between Scottish Government and the wider academic community. There's a plethora of research out there available in Scotland about how to do things better, how to evaluate public services, how to lead public service organisations. There's lots of material and knowledge out there that I do believe that there could be taken further advantage of. But I also believe it's not just about central government. I think there's ways in which public sector bodies can come together and talk more and collaborate more. And again, with the involvement of the third sector as well. So there needs to be almost a complete reframing of the opportunities for these different knowledge actors to come together to get this right, as I said before. I think Ross Greer makes a good point about the tensions around time and delivery. But if the government is keen on a new way of doing public services, I think now's the time to really get it right and having that space to do it.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Clark.
I was just going to make the point that clearly there have been kind of weaknesses in terms of the impact of the reform agenda in the past. They've been, you know, well rehearsed and well reported. The Christie 10 years on commentary around the fact that we haven't really delivered on that prevention agenda and improved outcomes is well accepted, I think. But there are also some positives for us to think about as well. We saw during the COVID-19 pandemic incredible collaborative working between the NHS, local government, communities, and the central and local government relationship, really focusing on trying to really improve and protect communities, protect health, protect jobs, and so on and so forth. And there were things that happened during the COVID-19 pandemic that, frankly, would have been unimaginable hitherto. You know, people implemented changes in the space of a fortnight that would have been taken years and perhaps never even happened. Now, I'm not for a minute suggesting that we should revert back to another pandemic, but I think we should ask ourselves, how was that possible? What's that told us? And I think what it's told us is where there's a shared desire to focus on and deliver improvements, public bodies can do it, mm-hmm. and communities can be part of it as well. I think the question I think is that's really important right now is how do we continue with that focus, that collaborative leadership, that energy and that dynamism at a time when there isn't that single unifying focus? Mm-hmm. Because the history, I think, of the period prior to that in terms of the Christie was, we didn't see that level of focus. So I think there's a question that we should perhaps explore together. People need to reflect on how do we get that energy back into the system.
So why do you think that happened? Was it a case of there was maybe more money in the system, people weren't too protective about budgets, or was it more appetite to take some risks where it wouldn't be before? Or
I don't think money was the driver, if I'm being honest, Mr. Lumsden. It seems to me that what was happening there was people recognised there was something that was a burning platform for change. People accepted that there was stuff that they needed to do together. And in that context, they did take more risks. You know, people made changes, did things perhaps at pace, perhaps with slightly reduced governance, mm-hmm. slightly elevated risk appetites. And I think we need to just pause and take breath and take stock and say, how do we get the balance right between, you know, that level of energy and change, perhaps a bit more rigour and structure around it, perhaps a bit more clarity of purpose around it, But how do we draw on those things, really, Mr. Lumsdale?
Mm-hmm. Ms. Payne, did you?
I think there's the twin approach. I think because there's what needs to happen now, and then it's what's looking to the longer term. But reflecting on the sort of the COVID period, I think there was also a great honesty with the public that these were difficult decisions that we needed to make, and we worked with the public and that kind of ongoing dialogue. So things like the way the NHS, that minor ailments was expanded, that the NHS near me was developed really quickly, and there was public buy-in and appreciation of what was going on, and honest with the public that there's some difficult decisions, we're trying to do this and we're taking you with us. And that kind of collaborative approach with the public, with our public services, with politicians, rather than it kind of being a, well, if only we had a bit more money, you know, this is the reason nothing's happening. If only we had more money, whoever's fault it is that we don't have more money is this magic answer. And I think we've gone back to somehow just perpetuating that myth that's the answer. If somehow somebody else's different policies will give us more money and that will fix things. Whereas I think having that honesty and saying, look, if we're looking to the long term, what do we want to do? How do we want to reform? In the First Minister's campaign to become elected, he committed to the BMA's national conversation on the future of the NHS. Now, he hasn't yet actually commented on that since becoming First Minister, but that's an important conversation. The BMA has called for it. Other organisations are saying, how can we reform the NHS? How can we? And I think that's being an honest conversation, that reform doesn't mean public or private. There is so much more depth to that conversation in terms of, if it's taxpayers funded, then you have to rationalise healthcare. What needs to be localised? What needs to be centralised? What is specialist? There are so many important conversations, but that needs to be had in conjunction with the public. We need to say, well, do we need all orthopaedics to be done in all localities? Can we have specialist hospitals? What needs to be done locally? What can be done centrally? The very fact that we've got more people going private shows that they're, you know, willing to travel further. Is there an opportunity there? Why aren't we having that conversation? And I think it's actually also the realisation and saying to people that we're going to start these conversations now. We're not going to have a better NHS by Christmas or by the next Scottish election, but we're having this conversation now so that in 10, 15, 20 years' time, our NHS is still there. And so that's just one topic. We've got all the other public services that we need to have those conversations with. And that, you know, talking and that honesty that we had with during COVID, where we're saying, like, oh my God, this is a shock to the system. How do we address it? How do we deal with it? How do we work together? And I think there was a comment, I think John Swinney has previously told the committee that that making Christie a reality requires a collective national endeavour. And I think that, you know, if you're looking to the long term, we need that collective national endeavour, that if we're wanting to reform, we have those conversations, we have those honest discussions that that are difficult. And I think that's the thing. We can't pretend there's no difficult decisions.
And why do you think we don't do that just now? Just because there's too many political red lines that people wouldn't touch? I'm thinking things like tuition fees, for example, you mentioned earlier.
Yeah, totally. I mean, if you look at going back to the NHS, so often the political dialogue on the NHS reform is about what is public and what is private, despite the fact that the vast majority of the public's first and only interaction with the NHS is with a private sector contractor, whether it's their GP, whether it's their pharmacist. In fact, where we've had expansion in recent years is through pharmacies, private sector contractors. But yet, the political dialogue is often reform means public or private. And actually, if you are honest with people, the biggest question we get any time we've done anything on NHS or done something around GPs, we'll say, oh, you want to privatise GPs? We're like, no, they're already private sector contractors. If people don't have a general understanding of how the public service works to begin with, how can you bring them with them in terms of bringing in reform? And I think it's that sort of honesty and collaborative approach and saying, you know, what are the red lines? But having a national discussion about those red lines. And, you know, is it we want to maintain free at the point of use? That's the red line. So how do we ensure that that survives? Those important conversations need to be had rather than the working to a timescale of an election, mm-hmm. which I say that with the being able to sit on this side of the desk and realise the difficulties of that. But I think that's why that sort of collaborative approach across politicians that we've said on things like the future of social care, having the parties work together, it helps provide that buy-in from the public as well, because you can see that if the parties are working together, there's political consensus of around a problem, we need a long-term solution, we're working together.
Ms. Pennell, if I can just stick with you a second. You mentioned earlier about, you know, it should be localism and, you know, maybe view, because there was a couple of things we've heard, actually. The former finance secretary, we were expecting some sort of blueprint to come back about public sector reform. The deputy first minister, former deputy first minister, then came and said, well, we're going to leave it to the organisations, you know, each local government or whatever. They can, you know, we've given them that five themes, they can go off and do their own thing. What way is it going to work?
I think there's a difference as well between, I think the local solutions is really important, and also reflecting the fact that what works in one area, what's a great local solution in one area won't necessarily work in another area. And I think centrally it's important to accept that there will be differences across the country, and that, you know, if one local authority or chooses to do something, that if centrally government starts trying to intervene and say, we can't do that, or you can't do that, or if you're doing this, and it makes mockery of the whole element of localism and different solutions and how they impact different areas. So I think there's definitely room for local solutions, but if it's just about efficiencies, I think that's my concern about the sort of the way that the public reform has been spoken about. It's just we need to deliver efficiencies to meet our budget constraints, and that I don't believe is reform. That's just simply trying to meet the budget constraints.
Yeah. So it's supposed true reform or salami slicing for all these different organisations. Professor Connolly, do you have anything to add on that?
Yeah, I was just thinking about your point when you made reference to the former Deputy First Minister's comments about, you know, localism. I think the instinct, again, around localism is right and is important, but I think there's real dangers around this. I think the COVID pandemic, although, you know, as Anthony said, you know, there was some really excellent innovations that happened during that time. But there are also some issues. I mean, if we think about the challenges around health and social care, the government, you know, basically admitted that they didn't understand the health and social care system sufficiently enough in terms of the response. So it's all fine and well at a day-to-day level, saying, OK, localism's fine, devolve responsibility. But what if something goes wrong? And what if you need that intelligence to make adequate crisis management measures? Could it be the case that perhaps, you know, the government becomes a bit of a hostage to fortune because of that overly devolved approach, not having the local knowledge to make national level policy decision making? So although localism is important, and I would argue for it, there are dangers with it as well. And I think that balanced approach, as we've spoke about, is required, because, you know, when the next pandemic does come along, how do you know you'll have the tools and knowledge there to put in place that adequate response?
Mm-hmm. Mr. Clark, anything to add on that? Because I was going to ask one last thing, if that's okay, convener, that we'd heard before about a local governance review, and that seems to have went quiet now in terms of the Scottish Government. It's something that is meant to be coming back, but we haven't really seen. And I would have thought that would have been part of the key reforms coming forward. But
I think we're very clear that the local governance review has great promise in terms of supporting change and innovation and trying to balance that national and local dynamic, really. You know, allowing local government and their partners to respond to their local circumstances, giving them more power to make changes that they want to make to their services in collaboration with others. You will have heard, I think, complaints from local government that it sometimes feels to councils as though change is imposed upon them and policy is imposed upon them by the Scottish Government. The New Deal, I think, is about striking that balance between local and national choices and policy making. I was just going to make one quick point on the previous bit, if that was okay. I think we're all committed to localism and community engagement and community having a big part to say in terms of the reform agenda. But I think we also need to acknowledge that there are tensions as well. The whole postcode lottery question, you know, people wanting consistent services is a tension in this localism agenda. And I think there's a tension between that localism agenda and the quite understandable expectation of having consistency of services across the whole of Scotland. And that's just something we have to kind of live with, really. And I think we do need, to borrow your phrase, Alison, a bit of honesty about where that balance lies between national standards of services and local discretion. That feels like quite an important issue that that the Scottish Parliament, the Scottish Government and their partners have been wrestling with for quite some time. But to return to your question, Mr. Lansdowne, yes, the New Deal does feel very, very important in terms of potentially giving more powers, more discretion to councils and their partners to deliver local responses to local challenges. So we're quite excited by it. And I know local government's very excited by it as well. Mm-hmm.
But it should that not be part of this reform?
Yes, of course it should. Of course mm-hmm. it should. And I think it's very difficult to see this reform being delivered effectively without that New Deal forming part of its, if you like, architecture or superstructure.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you. And now Michael Marra.
Thanks, Convener. I suppose I kind of hear a pretty welcome consensus, I think, around all of you and the submissions that we've received around this about sense of real need, urgency, and you're all describing similar drivers as to why this should happen. And so far I'm hearing a kind of a pretty comprehensive rejection of the previous Deputy First Minister's approach of saying we can just let folk get on with this, that actually there needs to be some kind of intent. So my question is to all of you is, why is this not happening? And why has it not happened? Mr. Clark.
It's a question that's probably better put to the Scottish Government than to the panel members.
I would reject that slightly, Mr. Clark, if I can, because it feels to me that's the nub of the question here. So what do you identify as the restrictions that are stopping this from happening?
Sorry, I wasn't trying to evade your question. Okay. I am going to answer it.
Thank you.
Just making the point a better place than I am to give you their rationale for where they are at the moment. I think if we're being fair to the Scottish Government, it takes time to work out what you're trying to do. So I guess I see some of the statements that we've seen so far as, if you like, statements of intent in terms of some of the principles that might underpin the reform agenda. And I think what we would expect to see, hopefully in the relatively short term, is a more worked up plan with a bit more specificity around what the reform agenda might look like in terms of reshaping and remodelling of public services, plans and strategies for engaging communities around the change agenda, what success might look like, some actual measures of success. I'm not necessarily talking about specific performance indicators, but at least something that one can, if you like, look to and measure progress towards in terms of improvement in public services. So I suspect that's something that will come hopefully in the medium term, Mr. Marrow.
Other comments on that? I mean, I would say time frame. I mean, it's 12 years since Christie was published. 12 years. I suppose what I'm trying to get to is there a character in our politics and our public services and the way that we do things in Scotland that is stopping change? Professor Connolly?
Thank you. Now, I think, yeah, it has been a significant amount of time. And I think it's a question of priorities, but also I think it's a question about a lack of strategic grip on the issue. I think perhaps there's not been enough capacity centrally within government to work across boundaries to try and get this right. You know, if we're going to have a new model for Scotland or a new public services model, there has been opportunities to think quite carefully about that. There was a number of developments about 5 years ago around integration, a bit more now, the integration of health and social care, linked to the empowerment agenda as well, building on the national performance framework. But it just seemed to be that a lot of the style of policy making was quite path dependent, rather than taking that pause to think, okay, let's get this right. And perhaps there has been a degree of policy distraction on other issues, you know, maybe constitutional matters that perhaps, you know, could have been invested more within thinking about how Scotland works and how it could be more effective as its own polity. So I think there's a number of political reasons, but also think there's a number of institutional reasons. Also think that perhaps there's been, and to be fair to the government, perhaps there has been the idea from the early days that performance indicators are the way forward and that we need to hold local government and agencies to account through indicators. But indicators tell you very little about what actually works and how to do things better. So I do think perhaps there's been a slight, you know, misguided way of thinking about how to make things better to improve. So again, you know, I keep banging the drum on evaluation, but I do believe that's very important and how to understand how to do things better. So there's been a lack of investment in that, I would say.
Okay. So, I mean, in the paper that you produced in 2020, you said what differentiates Scotland is the acute level of policy focus upon constitutional matters leading to policy distraction. That's a quote. I mean, could you unpack that a little bit for us? I mean, why does that... Is that just bandwidth, or is it something more structural?
I think it is bandwidth. I mean, I think there is the structures there in Scotland to do things better. I mean, I did write that, and I do believe that. I think that, you know, when it comes down to a vision for government, there's choices that you have to make about whether or not you want to make sure that Scotland has the best public service and that's fit for purpose for the modern economy. But if there is that degree of distraction centrally on wider constitutional matters, there's always an opportunity cost. And that's the reality of any public policy, there's opportunity cost. Is it the overriding factor? No. Is it a factor? Yes, I think it is. But I do. My own view is it's about the infrastructure in Scotland and the leadership around trying to get it right. As I said before, I do believe there was some well-intentioned approaches there through the National Performance Framework, the Commission, the Christie Commission, all very important in getting to thinking about outcomes and thinking about the social problems of our time. But the architecture just hasn't been there. That's the key.
Okay. Alison Payne?
I think the electoral timetable simply means that, you know, going back to the sort of honesty with the public, that politicians by nature don't want to have to say, well, you know, maybe that hospital ward might need to close and maybe you won't be able to get your hip replacement just down the road, you'd be better travelling a couple of hundred miles and justify that decision. I think that there's a whole load of difficult decisions, and I think, to be fair to the Scottish Government, I don't think since Christie there's been in any of the manifestos any particular great reform set out across for public services.
Can I challenge you a little bit on that? Because I wonder in terms of, so for instance, the approach taken to closing the attainment gap. So this approach taken in Scotland to bring fence a certain amount of money that was to go into pupil equity funds rather than to change the way that things were delivered. Where this has worked and the areas that the former First Minister went to study in London, New York, there were significant policy change and ways that public services were organised. She rejected that and went for a cash injection. Mm-hmm. So the other places work across and have perhaps more of an appetite for reform. Why is that choice made here?
I don't think it's anything to do with, you know, Scots or our inability to kind of take on. I think, as Professor Connolly said, that there has perhaps been other issues that have been dominating our discourse. Not just, you know, the Constitution, but Brexit has also had that kind of talking about those issues, whereas, you know, we're talking about public sector reform, but that's like, you know, every single public sector area we need to look at and reform. That's an awful lot of discussion looking in the longer term. You can't do everything all at once. And it's not exactly a great manifesto pledge to say, you know, in 15 years' time, we're going to have an excellent NHS. But that's the kind of discussion that we actually need to be having. It's that sort of the twin track. And that's where, you know, coming together and perhaps the committees of the Parliament can have a greater role, actually, in looking and that collaborative approach. How do we pick up the reforms that have been placed elsewhere? What can we learn? What would work? What won't work? And help push that discussion. Because at the moment, there's plenty of discussion going on outside of politics about, as I say, it's the BMA that's called for this national conversation. People are crying out for a discussion on reform. It needs that kind of a sort of a buy-in from others that, yes, that means there will be winners and losers, and that there will be whatever the reform is, there will be some things that some people don't like. And we need to just actually be honest and say, look, if we want to protect this service or if we want to actually meet the attainment gap, you might not like this, but let's try it. And also accept that on the attainment gap and how we deliver education in our schools, what works in an inner city school will be different to what works in a rural area. And that's okay, because we have our local authorities, we have democratic accountability, and if local authorities choose to do something different, that's okay, because local people, if they don't like it, can vote out those local politicians. But we need to be okay at saying that. I mean, some of the discussions we've seen and things, even around like workplace parking, the debate in the Scottish Parliament should have been, you know, yes, if everybody likes localism, just leave it to the local authorities, because it should be up to each local authority, because what is decided on workplace parking in inner city Glasgow is, of course, different to in Moray. That's okay. It's okay to be different across Scotland. We're a very disparate nation. We have huge differences in terms of population. The demographic challenges that we've spoken about already will be faced wildly differently across Scotland. We need different solutions. So there is that kind of collaboration that is required about what is required in one area and others.
Thank you. Anthony Clark.
I'm sorry, I misunderstood your earlier question, Mr. Murrough. I answered the question around the current reform proposals rather than the Christie question. And if you're asking me why is it we haven't delivered Christie 10 years on, it seems to me that that's partly because we weren't clear what we meant by delivering Christie. And we didn't actually specify what success would look like at national and local level in terms of what Christie would be in terms of improved outcomes, different models of public service delivery, and so on and so forth. So therefore, what we tried to do was overlay Christie on a whole set of existing policies, priorities, governance arrangements, funding models, and therefore that, I think that meant that it got diffused and got dissipated and became just something that was operating in the background, and people could talk about, well, I'm doing Christie. Well, what do you mean by doing Christie? It became a convenient shorthand for whatever anybody wanted it to mean.
Can I maybe push you a little bit on something you said earlier on as well, Mr. Clark? You mentioned about the COVID response and innovation around COVID. I mean, I think one issue around that was perhaps around the availability of methadone available to people who had drug addiction, a substance addiction that they could take at home. And that became far more widespread rather than having to attend a chemist. Part of my worry around that as a policy is the elasticity. It's bounced back. And is there a reason that our system has pulled back from those innovations and said, in actual fact, we want to retreat back to the norm?
I suspect there are probably many reasons why that's happened, Mr. Murrough. People spoke at the height of the pandemic about Build Back Better, and that being the ambition, and to use the pandemic as a learning opportunity to do things differently. I think we've seen, not just in that particular policy area, other policy areas, people reverting back to the way things were before. There are probably many, many reasons why that's happened, Mr. Murrough. It's probably human nature. The kind of old habits die hard. It's probably, I think, in response to Mr. Lumpton's question, we talked about the risk appetite. People's risk appetite's reducing now. So I think there's probably quite a lot of factors at play there, Mr. Murrough. I'm not sure I could specify a single one.
You get what I'm trying to kind of push out here, though, about the structural issues.
Yeah.
And so my final question, Convener, is do you get any sense that those fundamental blockages, and I agree with Alison Payne, I don't think Scots are averse to reform and change. It's absolutely nothing in a national character the way they do things. It's something in our politics and structure. Is there anything that is changing those blockages at the moment, or that there's potential for change? I mean, you've talked about increasing demand, but is there something that we can kind of have some hope that there might be a change to the political and structural setup?
I think we are all very hopeful, and perhaps the fact that there's a new administration, and that I think that's maybe, again, to use Anthony's comment earlier about looking at asking the committee that question, is there hope that the politicians can work together more? Is there hope for more collaboration? That rather everybody being in one camp or another, but recognising that just because you have one view on one political issue doesn't mean that you might not actually have something to contribute in another area, and that there are areas of agreement and there are areas of disagreement, and that you know, just because you disagree in one area doesn't mean that the other person is the worst person on the earth and isn't worth listening to. And I think actually trying to be more collaborative, and actually as a nation having those discussions where we're willing to work together and listen to each other and move forward and recognise. Because if we all start from the point of we want to preserve and maintain our public services, then we are all starting from the same point. It's just like, well, how do we get to that end goal?
I'm cautious about being too optimistic because I'm an auditor and prudence is a basic accounting concept. But what I would say is I observe increasingly public bodies talking about what they need to do together, not what they need to do themselves. And a recognition that, you know, although efficiency isn't the whole story here, if we are going to drive efficiencies, that is best done by people looking across the system and taking a systems view. So I guess I'm cautiously optimistic about that.
Professor Connolly's nodding at that point, isn't it?
Cautious optimism, I think, is correct. I think, absolutely, I do a lot of work with health and social care partnerships through my research and do a lot of work to try and understand some of the systemic issues within the system. But when I speak to chief officers and those that work underneath the chief officer, there is a real appetite to do things differently to benefit their communities and to make life better for people. So there is a strong optimism within the system. I think, going back to what Alison Payne was saying, that perhaps it's about fronting up nationally and saying, do you know, we're going to try some new things, we're going to pilot, we're going to experiment, and we're going to allow for intelligent failure, potentially, and make sure we learn the lessons from that. But the only way in which innovation builds itself into the system is by trying new things. And I believe that that's something that perhaps is missing from the current agenda at the moment.
Thank you. Thanks, Camilla.
Okay. Thank you. Liz Smith is next.
Thank you. Ms Payne, can I take you back to one of your first answers this morning where you said, and I quote, that efficiencies don't equal reform. I entirely agree with you on that. And I want to put that in the context of what the Scottish Fiscal Commission has been forecasting in its sustainability report, where it's very clear, and I have it in front of me, that when it comes to health spending, health increases from 35% of devolved spending in 2027-28 to 50% in 2072-73, and they are projecting that there's going to be very little decline in spending on social care and social security, as in pretty grim in terms of the money that we need to ensure that we are sustainable for the future. I think your answers, in fact, all the panel's answers this morning are very interesting about what we need to do with public sector reform. But the other part of this is what we do about taxation. Ms Payne, you mentioned in your submission about broadening the tax base, and you gave us some suggestions about how that might happen. But just as important in that is whether we have to restructure the taxation system. And you hinted, I think, in another answer that we probably do. And I just wondered if you could give us your thoughts on reforming the taxation structure.
Certainly. I think what I would start with is that Reform Scotland has previously said, and we continue to say, that with the financial settlement in Scotland, all our eggs are in one basket, as it were, with income tax. It's over three quarters of revenue income, and it makes it very difficult to look across the board at how you know, and the risks there about if you experiment too much, you could, you know, the very wealthy can move, and we've got, I think it's something like only 1% of all income taxpayers in Scotland are the top rate payers, compared to 2% in England. So there's limits. We're far too reliant on one small tax, and there's not a great deal we can do. We do have powers over new taxes, and I mentioned about looking at things like wealth, and particularly immobile wealth. I think that's the key thing, is immobile wealth, because for obvious reasons you can't shift it down south or to more competitive tax environments. But I think it's looking at creating a tax system in the round that can attract people. I think, yes, we need to broaden our tax base, and we also need to clearly get more working age people. We need to get more people contributing to our revenue. And so what we can do to create a competitive environment that brings people into Scotland. But we're also looking at local government financial powers as well, that we believe too much is centralised at the moment. So we would want business rates and council tax to be fully devolved to local authorities, so that they could amend them and design them to fit their local circumstances. So if one council wanted to introduce a land value tax, or somebody else wanted to do a local income tax, that they were able to address their financial concerns and their interests in their area. But yes, I think that there is still a limit on what we can do. And I think, as you outlined, the projections on health spending are scary. And that's why we need to do something now. That's why we need to... And so maybe there are issues around, if you're honest with the public and say, right, as we've suggested, OK, we're going to put, say, a penny on income tax, because we want to start implementing radical reform on how we pay for social care. So if we start doing that now, and we put together a cross-party group looking at, well, how do we fund it in the longer term? Is it some sort of social insurance that's required? How do we actually fund a social care system that is fair for all, and looking at different options so that, are there issues around, as I say, a social insurance or other funding methods that we can develop to pay for those things? Healthcare, we massively need to look at early intervention to prevent some of those things coming down the line, and we haven't been able to afford to pay those. The other areas, looking at our the powers that we have, there are some discussions around about the fiscal framework review. Now, while we can't borrow for revenue costs, if it's borrowing for investment, is it something saying, right, this is a short-term project, can we expand our borrowing power so that we can fund some sort of and pilot and experiment with reform to see what can happen, to see what we can use and to develop these things. But we need to start now so that the sort of figures that you're talking about, we're not keeping our head in the sand until we get to the sort of 2050s where it's unsustainable.
When we had the Scottish Fiscal Commission in several months ago giving evidence on the general sort of economic situation, they were very strong in their views that there should be an all-party, well, not just all political parties, but a whole number of stakeholders involved in a tax commission that would look at this issue. Is that the view that you would subscribe to as well, to ensure that we get at least some kind of consensus about what is economically and socially good for the country rather than what is the political agenda? Is that something that Reform Scotland would support?
Absolutely, definitely.
Right. From an Audit Scotland angle, can I just ask the same thing that, obviously, you're not in a position of being able to advise government on policy as such. But it, again, from an economic and a social perspective, so serious are the future trends that we're having to deal with, which, as I say, they're summarised in front of me here just now. Do you think that the best way forward on advancing a discussion about changing tax structures, particularly in line with our changing demographics, is the best way forward?
There needs to be alignment between ambitions and funding, and tax is part of that.
Yeah. Professor Connolly, do you subscribe to that too?
Yeah, I agree with the panel members. I think having a conversation about tax is very important. A tax commission, I think, would be a good idea. And I think taking it out of politics and actually sitting down and being honest about what the options are and the costs and benefits of each option and what that would mean for public services and making them sustainable for the future, I think is very important. I think it goes back to the heart of the other issues we've been looking at today. It's about having a national conversation and actually not shying away from some of the more challenging areas of public policy.
I mean, obviously, there is a difference between the tax structures and the rates of tax, which tend to be much more political in many ways. Ms. Payne, you recommended when you were answering the first question that tax is something that needs to ensure that Scotland is competitive. It's the best place to come to live, to work and to invest. What recommendations would you make to ensure that Scotland, from a tax structure basis, is more competitive with the rest of the UK and with other countries indeed?
Well, I think on that one, I'd come back to the first point I made about the restrictions on the powers that they have in terms of, at the moment, it is only on income tax that you can really, in terms of how you can be competitive. I think you can make arguments about why it might be higher. I think what we have found, though, is that to say that you're getting free tuition fees, or but that's coming with a problem, or the other sort of so-called freebies, isn't enough to sort of necessarily balance it out. I think there's also a feeling that because we have so few at the top rate, we have kind of expanded and we are targeting that kind of middle group who are, I think, as challenges become more apparent, there will need to be a proper conversation about universalism versus the sort of targeted support. So you could find that as more and more of the so-called taxpayer funded perks disappear, what is it that people are getting for that increased tax? Why would somebody come here? And I think what has happened over COVID is that you've got more and more people who can we're working from home, so therefore you can work from anywhere. Scotland is somewhere that you can work for. You may be, and so we want to attract these people. Come and live in our amazing country. Work from home if that's what you're doing. Come here. But therefore, why would you come here? What is the offer? And people may not move away because of higher tax rates, but we don't know who's not coming. So I think if... I've also said that, you know, Reform Scotland's talked about increasing taxes, but I think if you're doing it for a specific thing, like so we were talking about social care, I think that that kind of conversation with the public, saying, right, we're doing this for this specific purpose, but equally the threshold change between the UK and Scotland, the money that's been raised from that pretty much covers the small business discount. So you could equally argue that what has happened up here has seen transfers between earners to businesses, to small businesses. Now, that's a political discussion, but it's not really sort of saying, well, man in the street is paying more tax, but it's meaning that there's a child payment. Mm. There needs to be more of that kind of clear discussion that this is why, this is what is developing. We're trying to address child poverty, or we're trying to ensure that we can reach net zero, or we're trying to... do various things. That if you can set that message whilst also offering public services that look sustainable, we can attract more people to come into Scotland. We can attract people to come here to set up their businesses, to create more working age people, which will then generate more revenue, which will then help us into a more sustainable position. Mm.
I mean, just obviously one of the other findings of the Scottish Fiscal Commission, well, the Fraser Valley, all sorts of economic groups, is the fact that our ageing demographic is a really serious problem when it comes to the tax take, as is the fact that the declining share of the working population within the total population is really serious. And so I think we have to ensure that, not just talking about changing tax structures, which I personally believe is very important, but we actually have to ensure that the rates of taxation, whether that's on consumers or on businesses or personal income, make Scotland much more attractive than is currently the case. And Scotland is in desperate need of, you know, more higher paid, better jobs, so that people are attracted to come here. And I think the balance of tax structure debate as opposed to tax rate debate is actually very important in that. So your comments have been very helpful, because I think, you know, the problem is urgent. And I think we're getting the very strong message from the economists that we need to act, and as preferably on as cross-party a basis as we can.
Could I just add something quickly on that? And I think one of the things, when you said about more powers, but I mean, corporation tax legislation was passed to devolve it to Northern Ireland. There's an opportunity there to, if it's been devolved to Northern Ireland, could it be devolved to Scotland? Could we use corporation taxes as a way of attracting more businesses or doing something? I think it's not just devolving for its sake, but then you begin to build a basket of taxes that we can look and create more of an attractive tax environment. But I think there's an opportunity with corporation tax to do that.
Thank you. My final question is, would you, each of you, like to see not just a fiscal framework, which is obviously being reformed just now between the UK government and Scottish government, would you like to see a fiscal framework between the Scottish government and local authorities? Would that help matters?
Yes.
Yes. I think it would help.
You got a short answer for that one. Thanks. Liz, now Michelle Thompson, thank you for being patient and waiting till the end.
Alphabetical order, last letter. Thank you for joining us this morning. I've got a few different questions. First of all, Alison, I'd like to come to you. We've had a very interesting discussion this morning, but what we've not really touched on all that much is public perceptions, and arguably the public are behind the curve, and any change is either seen as it's going to cost me more or I'm going to get less. In your opinion, the step back from the former Deputy First Minister from the RSR, and as we now know that local bodies, whatever they are, will look at their own efficiencies or reform, and accepting all your earlier comments, where does the public fit in this? And to what extent is the new approach a missed opportunity for really making the public part of this burning platform for change, as I think Anthony said?
I think the public has to be part of it. I think the danger when it's down to individual bodies. I think the relationship with the public is less visible. I think those who engage with those bodies obviously have a vested interest and will be more aware of what's going on. But I think what we can see at the moment is that there will be issues around the local government budgets and constraints and individual cuts, but there's no kind of overarching strategy, so therefore the public are kind of just dealing here, there and everywhere. There's no narrative and explanation of what's going on or how we're trying to build back better or how we're trying to deliver reform. And I think it comes back to the fact that there is no actual reform. Efficiencies aren't reform. It's just we're trying to cut our cloth accordingly. So the only narrative and discussion with the public is, well, we need more money. Where's money coming from? Rather than the, well, things are difficult. So it's not just about money. It's the demographic challenges. This is how we're going to start fixing it. And I think we need to have those conversations in the same way that we need to have difficult conversations as to how we're going to reach net zero. People's houses aren't going to all of a sudden start having get rid of gas boilers if we don't talk to them, if we don't explain, if we don't set up the challenges and build that lead-in time. And I think the public will understand. They will want to protect. They will want to ensure that these public services survive. But I think it involves that if you have collaborative leadership across the parties, saying and having that discussion with the public and saying, well, whether it's a national conversation on the future of the NHS or it's local government reform or it's other areas, and saying, well, this is what we want. What do you think? And engage with them, whether I'm engaging in citizens' assemblies as part of those discussions, bringing the public in. So it's they're working with and understanding the issues that we're facing, that simply a constitutional question, whether it's with the EU, whether it's with the UK, is not going to answer any of these questions. These questions will remain whether we're in or out of the EU or whether we're in or out of the UK. We will still have to face these questions. So working with the public and having that sort of honesty, but it has to come from the top. And I think those conversations, if you're looking at real longer term reform, they have to start with the Scottish Government, and they have to explain to the public, this is what we're doing, this is why we're doing it, and we want your buy-in.
And both John and Anthony, is that something you'd agree with, that positive action to fully involve the public in matters? Anthony?
I couldn't agree more. It seems to me that change is coming whether we like it or not. You know, things will have to change in terms of the nature, shape, patterns of delivery of public services. That inevitably means some disruption, you know, and I think we'd be naive to think that everybody would be happy about what the future might look like, but I think if we involve people in the discussion, involve them in the conversation, if they have a voice and a say, we're more likely to end up with a set of public services, ways of delivering services that will be better suited to local communities. That seems an inevitability to me. There is a challenge, I think, because it can be a bit abstract. You know, public services, what do they really mean? I mean, they mean something when you need to go to the GP or the hospital, or you're taking your kid to school, or you know, your parents are going to a care home. We need to find a way of making this a meaningful conversation as well, and I think that's not quite so straightforward as we might imply in this conversation.
And John, I'm hoping from an academic perspective, you'll be able to add to this in terms of your recommendations of how the Scottish Government, if it did want to involve the public in that way, what the most effective ways are of doing that.
Yeah, I think public perception is key. I mean, the first experience that citizens often have with government is, you know, when they try and make a GP appointment, or they're told that their knee operation has been delayed or whatever. And I think that it's important to actually, for them on the ground, to understand that the government is listening and they're actually going to do something. So there has to be a national conversation. But in order to inform that conversation, there are a number of ways in which government might want to think about that. It could be through citizen panels, it could be through citizens' juries. There are ways in which those have been effective in a number of different issues across the world. You know, climate change, local action on climate change, some key social issues. So I think there are options there. But what I would say from an academic point of view is there are limitations to those deliberative forms of democracy, in that it does still require leadership. It requires those in power to cut through some of the debate and some of the dialogue. It's the manner in which you do it. It's being collaborative, making sure that everyone understands the pros and the cons, the opportunity costs. But those engagements with citizens are key to get to that point. So it's not to say that you can just hand everything over. to the public to make difficult decisions. That's the job of policymakers.
The framing, if you like. Anthony, I wanted to ask you, it's a sort of slightly technical question, but just to help furnish my knowledge. Of course, there's rules, as I understand it, as to what is deemed a public body and therefore is pulled into the figures, which I saw in your submission, the increase. But I suppose it strikes me that there may well be other bodies in receipt of public spend that don't fulfil that criteria, yet the majority of their money comes from Scottish Government. And I'm thinking of the analogy here, if you like, with IR35 in the private sector. Arguably, if those rules were applied, they actually would be deemed part of the public sector. Are you aware that this scenario exists? I'm not asking you to name anyone, I'm just asking that as a sort of principled question.
No, I mean, there are a whole range of bodies that receive public funding and provide public services that deliver public goods. I mean, ALIOs, I guess, are one example, and grant funding to the third sector as well is an important part of the whole landscape of the services that people experience in their communities, if that's what you're driving at.
Yes, so I suppose the point I'm making is that with the data that we have on the strict definition of public services, is that actually an underestimate of what the implications are, and that therefore when we're looking at public sector reform, the implications are greatly more significant? I'm just trying to get a handle
on
that.
Yes, I mean, if I might approach this in a slightly different way, I think there's a strong sense from the decisions I'm having with people in public services, be it the health service or local government, or indeed fire and rescue and police, that some of these bodies that we've talked about, ALIOs and third sector bodies, are really important players in the reform agenda. And I think they're crying out to be involved a bit more, really, as well. Mm-hmm. And we did see, I think we touched on this a bit earlier, we did see a great deal of engagement, support and activity from those types of bodies during the COVID-19 pandemic. It seems to me almost self-evident that they need to be part of the conversation moving forward as well.
OK, thank you. And my last question, convener, concerns, I mean, again, it's slightly more nuts and bolts. By getting individual bodies to look at their own efficiencies or reforms or however we want to phrase it, you're missing the opportunity for creating shared services, which is a not unusual way of getting economies of scale. And I'm thinking here in terms of multiple finance directors, multiple HR directors, and of course procurement, where you can get economies of scale. Probably for that reason alone, I was surprised at the kind of step back from the RSR, as it seems to me that, with the best will in the world, turkeys don't vote for Christmas. So could I have some commentary about whether you agree with me that they are perhaps obviously areas where you might want to start to look at, if not reform? I appreciate, Alison, your analogy. It's rather crude. I don't regard it as reform, but perhaps lower-hanging fruit. And since you're smiling, you may as well go first.
I think it depends on the particular bodies. I think for example, on local authority areas where you have that sort of democratic accountability, I think, yes, there are certainly, given the size of some of our local authorities, the opportunity to collaborate, and I think some of them do. But again, I would come back to my earlier point about it being bottom-up and kind of that sort of coming together. Yes, turkeys don't vote for Christmas, and I think in some of the other areas it would require leadership. So if you've not got the democratic accountability that perhaps local authorities would have, there are other areas where you could look at collaboration. For example, could you pilot some of the areas where you have coterminous boundaries with, say, health boards and local authorities? Could you do something with, say, Dumfries and Galloway and look at something that could help also work and improve the integration of health and social care in that area? Are there things that we can pilot that would enable a sort of giving that democratic accountability into the local health service and working in that area? But trying things in different areas rather than it being one and the same, but just looking and pilot and evaluating and trying different things. So yes, there would be a mixture, though, I think, of where you could have bottom up, but there would need to be some central political leadership involved.
Final comments from John and Anthony on this?
I think shared services has to be part of the discussion and part of the agenda. We have, a very mixed story of shared services in Scotland. Mm-hmm. You know, we've seen a number of them up and running, then sometimes they failed. I think the heat has slightly gone out of the shared services agenda over the over recent years. There was some interesting work published recently by the Improvement Service and Solis, which was a future operating model for local government, that was very clear, I think, that they felt that councils and their partners should be agnostic about who provides services. And that's not just agnostic about whether it's a council or the health board, it's agnostic about whether or not the best model is public or private provision or third sector provision as well. That feels quite important. Mm-hmm. If we look beyond the borders of Scotland to England and other parts of the UK, things like the combined mayoral authority in the north of Tyne, and if you look at what's happening in terms of the Manchester mayoral region as well, it seems to me to show that there is real potential gains to be had in terms of that sharing of expertise, sharing of capacity. I mean, Professor Connolly talked about capacity being an important bit of leadership and improvement. There must be something in this, but as with Alison, I don't think you can impose a model on different places, but there is also a need for some leadership from the top.
Okay, thank you. Final comment.
Thank you. I think it's also an opportunity to look at the roles within the public sector around those issues around shared services, because it could be that the workforce themselves has to think more carefully about how to do shared service, how to be innovative in the public sector, you know, what the skills that are required. Earlier I talked about, you know, workforce development and opportunities for public servants to actually enhance their skills when it comes to leadership at their level. Are we making big assumptions that, you know, individuals can just go ahead and do that? Like, okay, go and share your services and just get on with it. Well, actually, it might be a good idea to do some kind of audit of the skills that are there and the development opportunities that could be put in place to enhance the public sector towards shared services. So for me, the way I look at this is more about how to build that capacity at a human level, you know, in terms of occupations and careers within the public services, so that we do equip the modern public managers for, you know, the nature of society that we've got just now.
Final comment, convener, and I know I've still got some time, but I think it was yourself, John, that mentioned culture and innovation. I mean, there is a tendency with some people that reform the public sector means less of it, but the same structure and the same culture and the same behaviours, when really, and you distinctly made that comment about innovation. Final kind of thoughts from you all, how on earth, because at a change level it's extraordinarily difficult in any organisation to change culture and empower people, but have you got some final thoughts about that? It's the kind of how you would go about that. It's quite a challenge.
I think learning from other countries, I think bringing opportunities for individuals to learn from each other in terms of innovative projects that have happened. I mean, there have been innovative activities across the public sector, particularly around the digitisation of some services. You know, the opportunities to work on social innovation, perhaps bringing in third sector organisations to work collaboratively. So I think for me, it's about having the discussion about allowing that to happen. Skills around innovation are important, but at the same time, you have to see that in the context of the particular environment that you're in. So, for instance, within the health and social care setting, you know, you can have those that are expected to integrate within health and social care that are employed by different organisations or on different pay grades. They might also have different professional silos. And I think those are the things that have to be unpacked at a local level to allow for that dialogue around innovation to take place.
Alison.
I think the cultural things definitely is an issue, but I think it also depends on the specific sector area. I think there'll be different solutions in different areas. I think we've got the changes coming to the education bodies coming soon, and that one of the big things has been there needs to be a change in culture. You can't simply replace the name of the body and it's going to somehow be a new body. So that one's coming fast, and there's an opportunity to actually look at what happens there and working with teachers, working with the sector. And I think it's what will be right for the new education bodies won't necessarily be right for an integration between health and social, but it's working specifically on those areas with the sectors involved, with the people that work wider to the and feed into those bodies, and trying and failing and learning.
Thank you.
I think there's a lot of innovation taking place in Scotland at the moment, really, and I think it sometimes gets underplayed.
Right.
I think one of the issues is it probably is operating in small pockets rather than at scale. When I look at how public services are delivered in Scotland at the moment compared to when I joined Audit Scotland in 2003, they're really quite different in lots of areas.
Yes.
And there is a leadership issue here, I think, about creating an environment where people feel able to innovate and test, and the risk appetite thing that Professor Connolly talked about earlier is important. And my sense is that people that work in public services, they know that things are going to have to change. They're not naive. They see the budget proposals, they know what's going on in the health boards, the councils and executive agencies. And I think getting them involved in the process of deciding what the future models of public services are, drawing on their knowledge and expertise, is really, really important.
Thank you very much. Thank you, convener.
Thank you. Well, thank you to all of our witnesses. Is there anything that we haven't touched on today that you feel we should have asked you about, or you wanted to say that you haven't had the opportunity to say? No? Okay. Well, you're all looking quite happy. That's good. Well, if I can thank you all very much indeed. I've certainly found that fascinating, very helpful. And this has been our kind of scene setting for this inquiry, which we're going to be continuing with. So we'll be continuing to take evidence on the Scottish Government's public service reform programme at our next meeting. And that concludes the public part of today's meeting. The next item on our agenda, which will be discussed in private, is consideration of our work programme. Thank you very much.